Oh, hello everyone. Happy Friday. Happy Friday. Welcome to No Bullshipping with Hope White. No Bullshipping with Hope White. Thank you so much for joining us today. Boy, this week has really been something, but oh, how thankful I am that we have made it to Friday. I am so excited about today's episode and today's guest. As many of you all know, I am the CEO and founder of HD White Logistics and HD Dredge and Container Services. So that means I play in the space of dredge and external storage services for shipping containers. So quite naturally on No Bullshipping with Hope White, I would find the premier guest for you all for shipping containers. And that is going to be Mr. Will Garza of Global Trade Containers. So I'm so excited to bring Will up. I don't want to hold off because I know everyone's going to have so many questions for him because this is a hot topic. So welcome, Will, to No Bullshipping with Hope White.
Thank you so much. I'm excited to be here. I know we've been trying to put this together for quite some time. And so, just excited to be here. I know you've got a great following. The conversations we have are wonderful. And it is Friday. So I feel like I've definitely, and I'm sure you have, earned this Friday.
Yes.
And, excited to be here.
Yeah, that is probably a bit of an understatement because I have worked hard for this Friday, but I'm just so thankful to have you. And again, I want to go ahead and get into questions because I have been hyping you up all week on my IG page, as well as with Let's Talk Supply Chain. So I don't want to hold anyone. I want to go ahead and jump into this interview because I have some questions and I know some of the guests there who are going to be watching have some questions as well. So first, Will, tell us who you are and what is or who is Global Trade Containers?
Absolutely. So I'm the co-founder of Global Trade Containers. My business partner is John Taylor. We started this company about 7 months ago. So I've worked in logistics and transportation the last probably 12 years on a corporate level, specifically an expedite, over the road, brokerage. I've pretty much done every position you can do except drive a truck. It's been, I think for me, I've always been fascinated with just logistics on a whole.
Yeah.
We'd spent a couple years with a startup working with containers. And about 8-9 months ago, we really looked at the big picture and thought it was time for us to go off on our own.
Absolutely. So much like myself, you're coming out of supply chain, you found a niche and you all just took hold of that niche and just shot off.
Absolutely. It's, I always refer to it as what comes first, the chicken or the egg.
Yeah.
For us, it was the farm, which is, it's a really good place to be.
Yeah.
I think nobody could have anticipated, right, some of these issues we see on a global domestic level with supply chain based on COVID. And so I think it's forced a lot of people to get creative with solutions and adapt.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we saw the opportunity and here we are.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We got some people checking in with us early because I told you today is going to be a hot show. No Bullshipping with Hope White. We going to talk some trash today. So I want to take some few seconds here and talk to some of our guests. So good morning from Larry Long. He says, what is a container? He says, just kidding. we have Rob joining us from San Diego. What's up, Rob? We have Sarah. Oh, my God. Hey, Sarah. And then we have Nicole tuning in from New York. Oh, girl, cover up because I know you cold up there. Okay. So getting into exactly what GTC does, could you share with us how many units you all are moving or selling right now? What's your goals?
Sure. So we offer quite a few different things. And, I consider us an international supply chain solution company. So, our primary focus has been shipping containers, right? We work with suppliers in Asia, in Europe, in South America. We support them as they bring equipment in. And then we work on the wholesale level here in the US and Canada. Right now, and this is kind of a neat story, right? I'm a big fan of growth.
Yeah, right.
And organic growth and it's humbling, right? So when we first started the company back last September, you know, I think our first month we set our budget and forecasting. Yeah. And I think our first month we probably did maybe 50 to 75 containers. Here we are 7-8 months later, and we're averaging probably around 11 to 1200 containers a month.
Shut up. You cutting big checks now.
Well, you know, it's, you know, I think for us, it's been humbling. And, yeah. And when I say that, you know, we focus specifically on the relationships and how we can provide value. Right. And so I think for us, looking at scaling and volume, if you have the right relationships and you take care of people, it opens a lot of doors. And so I don't think we could have ever anticipated this growth. When you go back and you look at kind of our deck we put together, yeah. You know, we've pretty much shown, I'd say 8 to 10 times what we factored in we'd be. So yeah. It's, you know, it's a lot of getting creative, a lot of adapting, but it's been fun.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, just the sheer growth in my business since we've started in Dre's, you know, we started off maybe just a few containers here, but now the demand is just so ridiculous for our services. We're actually finding ourselves operating out of, you know, ports that we typically might not, like Charleston and Jacksonville, because the demand is just overwhelming at this point. But it's a great thing, you know, it's a great thing. So with your units with GTC, mm-hmm. with the pandemic and just the sheer demand of supply chain right now and maritime freight, are you seeing more orders or more requests for certain container sizes versus another size of container? So are you seeing more 2040s, more 40-40-45s, 53s? What are you seeing in your business as more of the units that people are requesting?
Sure. That's a great question. And so it's interesting because how crucial and vital really China is when it comes to manufacturing and containers. So all of the world's containers, most of them come direct from China.
Yeah.
So obviously everything affects everything.
Yeah.
Our primary, I guess you could say, probably our volume, our meat is going to be in the 20 standards, the 40 standards and the 40 high cubes. Mm-hmm. That's what we've really seen coming in, what's being sent in, mm-hmm. based on, you know, the vessel space, the demands. We've started to see quite a bit of a scale back with 40 standards,
yeah.
just because they're not producing as much. But we've seen a huge shift just towards 40 high cubes. You wow. can accommodate more space,
more product. Absolutely.
And it's been fascinating too, because, you know, we've seen in the last year and a half to 2 years, right, the demand has changed based on the specs and what's being produced. So, you know, 2-3 years ago, right, you weren't seeing a 40-foot high cube one trip, right?
Yeah.
That didn't have forklift pockets.
Yeah.
That didn't have lock boxes. Right.
Yeah.
But they were able to mass produce spec lease boxes, right, of mm-hmm. different colors at a faster rate.
Right.
So now you have an assortment of equipment coming in, but I would say that's kind of what we specialize in. We do sell the oddball stuff. We bring in the 20 high cubes, the double doors,
yeah.
45 high cubes and 53s as well. So it's
y'all are just like all over the place. Y'all firing on all pistons. That's like pretty cool.
It's a lot of equipment that, you know, we're bringing in, and
yeah.
you know, every customer's different. Right. And you
yeah.
know, we can get into more of that, but you know, we've yeah. got a few different verticals that we work out of.
Yeah.
And to add to that, you know, it's not just one trips, right? New containers. We also specialize in used containers as well.
Okay.
So you've got different grades. You've got, you know, everywhere from as is to wind and watertight to cargo worthy to IICL. And then you've got the one trips as well.
Absolutely.
So everybody's needs are different.
Absolutely. Now, I'll tell you, with me being in Dre's, most of my customers would probably use your services for the one trips. Sure. But I have been getting solicited here since we've been in the community of Candler County for storage services or either modifications for homes. Have you all had people trying to reach out to you for those containers, for those things as well?
Absolutely. So one of our largest verticals that we sell in is we operate, so business to business, we strictly do wholesale.
Yeah.
You know, one of the goals for JT and I when we started this business is we never wanted to compete with our customers.
Yeah.
And we wanted to keep things separate. And it's so right. important that our customers know that. So mm-hmm. we work directly with customers that are builders, right? Yeah. They're building homes. And it's, for me, that's one of the most rewarding parts of my job,
yeah.
right? Is when I get to go on site to see a customer, right?
Yeah.
I get to see the neat things they're building.
Definitely.
I get to meet their staff, right?
Definitely.
And I think for me, and I'm sure you can attain to this,
yeah.
I've always been so fascinated with what's happening behind the scenes. Right?
Absolutely.
I like to see the good stuff. I like to put on the boots. I like to get out there. And so it's really cool when you see how creative people are getting with containers. So absolutely. In terms of the equipment needed, it really depends. You know, for some of these builders, they specifically need, you know, new one trips. Some
yeah.
of them are willing to take a gamble on used equipment if the quality is there. So, but I've seen both.
Yeah. So we're going to get into that. I really want to go a little further with that, with the different types of containers, but I want to tell some other people hello, because I've seen some people jump into my comments and I've really been pushing like, hey, you better come on No Bullshipping with Hope White today. Okay. So I want to tell, hey, our listeners from Quantico, good morning. Thank you for joining us. We see Allison from England. Hey, Allison, what's up? Good day. Are we having a bit of tea today? We have Shakan from Toronto. And then we got Ebony from the big state of Texas, girl. I'm coming to see you. Get me some barbecue. How about Sarah joining us from Northern California? We have Balan joining us from the UAE. Thank you so much. Oh, we got a special guest, Anitra McCall from Supreme Transportation Group out of Atlanta. Thank you so much for joining us. So, Will, let me get back to you, because something I want you to go deeper, take a deeper dive in, is the different container sizes that you discuss. You know, you talked about the 53 feet. You talked about the 45s, the 40 high cubes. But to someone who's green, who maybe not be as well versed in the shipping industry as you and I, could you explain what a shipping container is and the different use for different sizes of containers, shipping containers?
Absolutely. It's interesting because, you know, working in transportation, mm-hmm. I don't think a lot of people understand how vital it is to our economy, right? Mm-hmm. Everything right. we see has been moved at some point, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And if you really look at where does most of the world's products come from,
mm-hmm.
right? A lot of stuff is coming from China. So
yeah.
when you look at a shipping container, most people see a metal box. Right. I see past that. I see the economy. I see
yes.
things moving. I see, right, like, you know,
I how we money. Build things.
I see money. As, yeah, right. I'm getting to that, right?
I see a gazillion dollars.
But, right. So containers have really become a commodity, and I don't
yeah.
think people really realize it, right?
Yeah.
So they started going to Trader Joe's and
yep.
things that they're used to getting every week, right?
Yep.
You know, it's funny when COVID hit, you know, my daughter needed a new mountain bike, right? So
right.
I'm going to different shops and I couldn't find anything because they were out of stock, right?
Exactly.
Well, you know, where are these being made? Where's the product coming from? So
yeah.
To kind of touch onto that, just in terms of a shipping container, it's a tool, right?
Okay.
And, you know, with all of the supply chain issues that we've seen, right, based on some of the changes on a global level,
right,
they have become more of a necessity, right?
Right.
And so it's the standard shipping containers you're going to see are traditionally that are going on these big cargo ships are going to be 20 standards,
right,
and 40 standards, and now 40 high cubes, which have come in because they can accommodate more in there.
Right.
So. In regards to grades of containers, right, you have
right.
a one trip, which
one trip.
Is basically a new container. They mm-hmm. call it a one trip because as it leaves China, right,
right,
it's already got one trip on it.
Right.
And then you've got cargo worthy containers, right, which is mm-hmm. exactly what it sounds like, right?
Yeah.
These containers need to be inspected. Mm-hmm. They need to be graded. They need to make sure that they're able to accommodate
mm-hmm.
the cargo that is being moved in these boxes. So,
yeah.
Traditionally, a cargo-worthy container shouldn't have any holes in it. The floor
right.
should be clean.
Exactly.
It's fully inspected. And so
yeah.
And then with that, you've got, right, wind and watertight, which is a step below cargo worthy. It's going to be a little bit rougher around the edges, but it can still do the job. So
absolutely. So if you're just joining us, we have Will Garza of GTC, Global Trade Containers. And Will is just talking to us about one trip containers and the industry that he and his partner are in and how they got over into that industry and they're scaling at a rapid pace. So Will, we've talked at a higher level, some of your high highs. Can you share with me some of the challenges GTC may have faced in the last couple of months since you've been trying to scale? Maybe it's competitors, maybe it's sourcing your one trips. Can you share what some of those challenges have been for GTC?
Sure. It's kind of funny because when people ask me what I do, the first thing that comes to mind is a fireman because of how many fires we're consistently putting out. And I think that's the environment I thrive in and we thrive in because we're here to be problem solvers, right? Mm-hmm. There wouldn't be a need for us, right, if we weren't fixing problems. So I think on a global level, the supply chain issues have just created just enormous amount of issues that weren't there before. So from a logistics standpoint, right, you've got so much congestion at these ports, right? Which means that, right, if we are bringing in equipment from Asia, right, forecasting is extremely difficult, right? So a lot of times our customers, right, everything is time sensitive. So what could be expected in 6 to 8 weeks, right, 2-3 years ago now turns into 3 months, right?
Right.
So I guess being a little bit more technical when it comes to visibility has been something we've had to deal with. It's been interesting because containers as a whole, it's become liquid gold, if you want to call it that.
All right.
And so the market for container prices in the last 2 years has been extremely volatile. And somebody phrased it to me best, containers that are on the ground that are coming in, it's day trading.
Yes, it is.
and I'm telling you, the market for pricing on containers, it's just so volatile right now. And I think one of the big gaps in the deficits is that we've seen a lot of greed. And I think one thing we look at is how can we, GTC, help stabilize this market and get it to a point, right, where our customers are able to come to us because prices have gone down, right?
And
it's stabilized and it's driving consumer demand, right? Because shipping containers, some of the verticals we sell in, right, and are successful are companies that are buying containers to lease containers, right? They build fleets right on the ground for construction companies. I mean, you name it. There's industries that you wouldn't even think use containers,
right?
But it's crucial to what they do because people love their stuff and they don't like to get rid of their stuff, right?
Absolutely.
So it's at that point when you look at prices, right, on a retail level, on a consumer level, right? If it's so expensive to buy a shipping container, it's no longer a cost-efficient way for consumers to store their products.
Absolutely.
So I think for us, right, it's the big picture. And we've been highly successful because, you know, we want to help get the market back to where it was. So I think for us, just finding that balance. But that's kind of been a struggle for us just is the pricing, right? It's how do we, right, to make, but how can we support, right, the economy and how can we support, right, stabilizing the market a little bit?
Right. So staying right there with pricing, because we're going to go there because we don't want to bullshit nobody. We don't want to bullshit nobody. Kind of go into the pricing because I'm going to, when I hear you say pricing, just for me as a drape provider here in the Savannah and Charleston market, when I hear you say pricing, when I first came into this side of the business, you know, our customers were paying or leasing containers for $6,000 to $8,000, maybe $9,000, maybe a little bit lower per trip on maybe a 20 or a 40 foot. But now some of my customers are telling me that they're paying $12,000 to $14,000. And in some cases, I've heard $19,000 for, you know, leasing their container for their products with transport. With those prices steadily increasing like that, GTC, must have a difficult time marketing when your customers are spending that type of, you know, dollars leasing their containers. So, I mean, like, how are you all getting around that, you know, staying competitive when you got pricing out there like that? Like you said, you were trying to stabilize the market, but how are you all getting around that?
That's a great question. And I think when I look at what we're doing, right, for us, we are not into international leasing, right? Okay. We strictly are buy and sell and move on a volume level wholesale. And so for us, I think what it's done is it's opened up a new avenue for us. We've just hired our vice president of international. And we also have a vertical that we offer called shipper owned containers. So we go directly to, you know, to Asia. We have somebody on the ground over there as well. Where we can offer the service as well. If people want more control, more visibility, more forecasting on the large amounts of cargo they're bringing over, you know, for example, ABC, you know, retail customer here in the state, they can go through us and they can actually buy containers direct with us from a factory level in Asia. We can support them with bringing their cargo over, and then we have a buyback program. So, you know, we work with them to find a fair market value for what the containers would sell here in the States, and we buy the containers back from them. And so this has been huge just because there's been so much congestion and there's been so much demand for space on these cargo ships. You've seen a lot of companies going and buying their own vessels or chartering their own vessels. So I think for us, we really haven't got into that arena of international leasing. And I think it's posed that question for a lot of companies, right? What do we want out of this, right? Do we want to continue to go and just lease containers and bring them over? Or is there a more cost-efficient approach, right? And through a cost analysis, we can put together for our customers.
Yeah.
It provides a different look at it. Most of these companies that are bringing over their containers, right, are getting hit with things that they never saw before, right? Detention, demerge.
Yeah, per diem. Come on over into my world with that.
all these extras, right, that people are making money off of, right?
Yeah.
But I kind of look at it as well, like ordering a pizza, right?
Yeah.
Hey, I just want to get a cheese pizza.
Yeah.
And now they're throwing all these toppings. You've got pepperoni, you've got sausage, you've got pineapple. And you're like, well, wait a second.
Yeah.
I didn't order all this stuff, but you're charging me for it.
You're charging me for it. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I want to tell some more of our guests hello and see if anybody has any questions for Will. I mean, Will has just been so informational into, you know, the wholesale purchasing and selling of shipping containers. And maybe you're interested in that. You want to know how it impacts you. Definitely drop some questions over in the comment section so we can ask Will and put him on the spot, because we got the man with the plan right here today. So Stacy Dunn, what's up, girl? How you doing? Thank you for joining us. I see that Saeed has been lighting up the comment section. Saeed made this comment. I want to highlight this because, of course, it references hope. But it says, with hope, we have some hope to recover from shipping containers disruption. So he says, all you need is a little hope. Sarah says, day trading. Wow. Can you expound on why you reference day trading to shipping containers?
Sure. Probably because it's such a volatile market to be operating in, right? If anybody's seen Wolf on Wall Street or any of these movies where, you know, it's there's nothing consistent about it. And I think we're starting to see a lot of points diverge in the same area. And so just with that being said, you know, I feel like when COVID happened, it really put a strain on our global economy and it backed a lot of things up. So a lot of these companies were forced to play catch up, and we didn't have an infrastructure here, right, that was set up for this.
Right.
And so what it did is it opened up, you know, these routes of too many containers coming in, right? Not enough space to be able to accommodate them, right? So now you've got an abundance of containers that are on the ground with nowhere to go. And so,
yeah, right, Hence, so then they come to Hope White for 10.65 acres of land in Meta, Georgia. Shameless plug. Yeah.
So that's exactly that, though, right? As shipping containers have become a gold commodity, let's call it that.
Yeah.
Right? Well, space has become a commodity as well. Absolutely. And I think it's, you know, for me, it's fascinating to see you and what you've been able to do as well, because, you know, your job is to be a provider, right?
Absolutely.
And to offer different services. And I think it's been exciting to see companies like ourselves, like you, really take that next step and create a market for these things. And just to kind of reference what you'd mentioned about some of the issues and how we've overcome them. You know, I've always said, and my daughter's 10, and I tell her, right, on a personal level, when we have talks, and, you know, she's a competitive swimmer and she does ballet, and, you know, she's got a meet coming up and there's some good swimmers.
Yeah.
I just say, honey, just stay in your own lane.
Stay. If you better say that, Will. You must have been on my live this morning.
If you just stay in your own lane, right, and you focus on the things that you can control, right?
Absolutely.
And that has been for me, right, the story of my life and business is, right, how can we just focus on what we're doing?
Yes.
There's always going to be competitors out there. Yes. That's just the way it is. But, you know, I also have a sense of empathy for our competitors because we're all in this. There's plenty of money to go around. We all, you know, offer different things. But,
right.
you know, for us, it's having a sense of empathy. I think that's extremely important in business.
Yeah.
And focusing on really growing the relationships you have.
Absolutely.
And being of service to your customers as well. So
absolutely. Absolutely. We do have a few questions that have dropped over in the comment section and I want to touch on those. So are you fine with answering some questions from our guests?
Let's go. Let's do a firing round.
Awesome. Let's fire it. So first question comes up is from Saeed, who says, what's your best mode to connect with your supplier? He says, we use a collaboration center where supplier and customer can discuss regarding a specific disruption. So what's been GTC's, if you want to share that, what's been one of your best methods of contacting your suppliers?
I probably should have taken Chinese in high school because for us, really, it's been just communication. I think for us to be able to go directly to the source and build those relationships.
Absolutely.
I know there's a lot of new networks that are being built out there to kind of open that up. I think coming from domestic transportation that is highly tech influenced these days,
right?
It's not quite at that level on a global scale for logistics, but we're getting there.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've seen a lot of people communicating on LinkedIn. But I think over the next few years, you're going to start to see more proprietary technology that's going to connect
absolutely
people globally.
Yeah, yeah. I just had a discussion with one of my customers yesterday about integration of technology, similar to, you know, blockchain logistics, of just making sure everybody's connected along the line. And so I'm looking forward to that because it definitely will help me in my business as well with what we do in Dre. We have another question here from Ebony. She says, Will, what does the timeline look like from receiving shipping containers from China to getting it sold? What does the timeline look like?
You know, if you asked me that 2 years ago, my answer would have been different. If you asked me that 6 months ago, it would have been different. It really depends. And that being said, right, when these containers come over, there's so many different like stops along the way. And I kind of like to think of it like when you've got a load you're moving, right? And this is our world trucking, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, you get that load and you realize it's doing four picks and eight drops, right? Yeah. So different things can come up along the way. It also depends on where you're sending the equipment, right? Probably the fastest lane is going to be going from China to LAX, right? But then you start looking, right? There's such a space crunch over there, right? People are looking at other options like Houston, Savannah, Charleston, Newark, right?
Yeah.
And then you start looking right at the domestic piece of intermodal. So what may have been a 6-week turn has now turned into a 3-month turn because, right, fuel's getting kind of expensive, right?
Yes.
Capacity is shrinking on the trucking side, right? And this is what I love about our job and what we get to do is, you know, you get to play operation, right? With all of these different things that contribute, right, to the end result.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Which you led right into my next question for you is how has fuel costs, because, you know, your girl has a Tahoe, okay? Thank you, Chevrolet Tahoe, for the vehicle. I love it. However, comma, semicolon, $125 to fill up my tank is getting a little excessive, okay? Yeah. So, Will, with the current rates and fuel, has that impacted your business as well? Does fuel costs impact GTC in any way?
Absolutely. I think it's everything is connected, right?
Okay.
Especially in logistics. And so with fuel going up, you know, obviously for us, we are not locked into any contracted rates.
Yeah.
But for us, just in terms of how much it costs, right? Because a lot of these customers we work with, right, we have so much demand for transportation because they want an all-in rate. So if somebody's buying a shipping container for XYZ price, right?
Yeah.
In a market where it's not accessible, right? Let me give you an example. If somebody's up in, you know, let's say Western New York or Maine, right? Mm-hmm. Most likely they're going to be pulling equipment out of a market like Boston or a market like Newark. So they're going to be relying on the transportation now. Mm-hmm. So now you've gone from buying a shipping container, right? Just the price of the shipping container. Now you've got to factor in transportation, right?
Yeah, that
gonna,
connection, that chain.
It's gonna affect their margin. So
yes,
you know, and that's important, right? Because you need to be able to know, right? This is my budget. This is what I'm selling at, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, let's be honest. The best sellers are always going to be the best buyers in any market, right?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. For us, it, you know, I always look at how we can help customers.
Absolutely.
I don't look at us as having a sales division. I look at it as what kind of value we can bring to our customers, right?
Yes.
What do I do? What do I need to do for you to help your business grow? And I think that's where we've been really strong is, right, being able to offer solutions like transportation, being able to work with the same providers, right? Being able to negotiate down those prices for our customers, right?
Right.
Through volume. So I think that's been also an issue we've seen as transportation has gotten so expensive.
Yes.
That it's forced a lot of these small companies, right, that make their bread and butter off of leasing or reselling shipping containers on the retail market.
Yes.
They've scaled back on their buying, right?
Yes.
So if you have an expensive a container that is 30% more than what they were paying the year before, and now you've got transportation that is an additional 30%.
Come on.
Well, right. So now that means that they've got to go up on their retail prices to accommodate. But going back to that, right, the question is, right, are consumers willing to pay that, right?
Yes. Somebody's going to eat that cost somewhere down the chain, and it ends up being the consumer.
Absolutely. So it's really, really important that, you know, for us, that we can all contribute, right, to helping stabilize prices.
Right.
And because we want to get the world moving again, right?
Yes, we do.
You know, we want to get, you know, the economy booming again. And so
absolutely.
That's something that we've really, really pushed towards working. And so, yeah, absolutely. Fuel has played a huge difference. And
absolutely.
So,
So given our conversation today, because Will, you have enlightened me so much, and I know you've enlightened some of our guests here of the shipping container world and, you know, buying and selling wholesale. Given our conversation here today, where do you see in your world, because you spoke on something that's very profound. You said staying in your lane. But in your lane, where do you see the shipping container world being in about 18 months? Do you see it being as robust as demand is still high, or do you see it that tapering off?
So I think what it's done is it's really put more eyes on global logistics. And I think it showed people, you know, and this is a great segue here, right? For us, we've been very humbled to, I guess, take a bad situation, right?
Yeah.
And take these lemons and turn it into lemonade.
Yeah.
And so that's a hard question to answer because there's a lot of moving pieces to it.
Yeah.
But what I do see is the market stabilizing a little bit more.
Yeah.
I do over time see prices coming down. Right. I do see volume scaling back up, and it's slowly been kind of getting to that point. But it's interesting because I remember last year, right, maybe about a year and a half ago, you know, what the price of a container was going for.
Right.
And every month it slowly crept up.
Right.
And on the customer side, it's, well, we're going to wait for prices to come down.
Correct. But
prices continued to scale up, and we've slowly seen them dropping down. So I would say in the next 18 months, I definitely see volume going back up, more equipment coming in to the U.S. and Canada.
Yeah.
The price is stabilizing a little bit more.
Yeah.
That's the goal, at least. So.
Yeah. Yeah. People always ask me that same question, and we're right in line. The market's stabilizing, can't stay high forever. We definitely have to get some stabilization in there. As far as volume, I don't see that tapering off. In the next 18 months in my lane, I see that volume still being just as high. What I do see is a lot of divergence pivoting back and forth from port to port. Like, you know, Savannah and Charleston in my market is doing this little ping pong thing right now. Mm-hmm. As soon as Charleston gets congested, then things go back to Savannah, so on and so forth. So, yeah. So, Will, thank you so much for coming on today. So if somebody wants to find you, let's just say somebody says, hey, Will, I want to buy 50 shipping containers because I want to do a small, tiny home community.
Sure.
How can they find you?
So, you know, it's a little bit embarrassing for me to say this, but I think that's one of the fun things about being an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're finishing our website right now.
Okay.
And we're doing all of our marketing and our social media. So right now, probably the best way is to just shoot me an email.
Okay.
I've always said the best way is just honesty. So I'm being honest here.
Okay. Shoot it straight.
But you know what? It's these are all good problems to have. And I say that because, you know, we have a run rate right now to probably be a $30 million company at the end of the year.
Wow.
And, you know, we're really humbled and we've worked really hard, but it all goes back to the people. And I think for us, we've been able to scale with 2 to 10, and by the end of the year we'll be at 20. And so I think it's just been a humbling experience and accelerated growth, if you want to call it that.
Absolutely.
But email would be the best way. And what I can also do is connect back with you in the next 3 weeks when we have everything set up, which is going to give us more exposure.
Right.
And you know, we're always happy to just to chat with people who have questions and and really just, you know, give them the insights that we see.
All right. Definitely. So we'll get that information put up with the podcast here. Definitely reach out to Will for any of your shipping global one trip needs here, or if you're a private consumer wanting to get into the shipping world. Thank you so much for everyone joining us today. Will, you got some comments over here. They loved you. You did so great. They said, hey, Will, you're amazing.
Well, listen, I hope to be back on this podcast in 6 months or 3 months and, you know, see if there's been any changes. And like I said, it's thank you for having me.
You're welcome.
It's been exciting. And like I said, it's, you know, we're really interested to see what happens in the next 6 to 12 months.
Awesome.
And hope to see, you know, a lot of good opportunities come out of that.
Most definitely. So thank you so much, Will.
Thank you.
We'll talk soon.
Thanks,
everybody. All right. Wasn't that cool? So you hear me talk about drays, you hear me talking to, you know, bring on, you know, transportation providers and the port. We talk about that, but how cool is it to get a little bit more insider information from a different perspective of just how those dollars are passed along the supply chain? You know, I educate on the side with Logistically Speaking Online, and I often tell my students about, you know, bidding and negotiating and rates and understanding that those costs are already put in place before your truck actually gets to your shippers, you know, just understanding how to take those rates. And look, Will came on and had that exact conversation with you. Okay. So I hope today's episode has been amazing for you, has been informative. Be sure to join us here next month. On next fourth Friday at 10 a.m., our next guest will be Diana Campbell with DTS Spade. She is a commercial real estate broker in the Georgia market, and she's going to come on and talk to us about what she's seeing with warehousing and the demand for warehousing and internal storage. Okay, so that's next month, fourth Friday at 10 a.m. right here. You better bring your butt back with no bullshipping with Hope White. Okay, if you want to find me, you can find me on Instagram at HD White Logistics. And then look for this video to get posted on Let's Talk Supply Chain's YouTube channel. All right. Have a wonderful day. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll talk soon.